So, real solar system, the mod that replaces the Kerbal system with our real solar system, which is over 10 times larger, the mod that is notorious for being super difficult because of how much delta V you need to do literally anything. Yeah, well, guess what? Too easy. Rookie
Rookie
numbers.
numbers.
Child's play. I present to you
Automated
Kerbinzilla, or
Laser
just
Machine.
Kerbin, but upscaled by 30 times, making it 3 times larger than real life Earth. In fact, I've made the entire Kerbal system 30 times larger, courtesy of a mod called Sigma Dimensions. In this video, I'm going to land on the supersized moon and return, and I'm going to do it all using only stock parts. Why? Well, I don't know. Kennedy said a thing once.
We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things, not because they are easy, but because they are hard.
Believe me when I say it, though, this is not gonna be easy. If you saw my last video on this topic, oh yes, rocket nuts, let's go, in which I simply just tried to get a probe onto an escape trajectory, you'll recall that it takes roughly 15 kilometers per second of delta V to even get into orbit around Kerbin, which is almost 5 times the amount normally required, and is almost twice what you need to orbit Earth in real solar system. What this essentially means is that you need an absurdly large rocket to actually get anything into orbit. In fact, just getting one Kerbal into orbit took a rocket of more than 4,000 tons, which is larger than a Saturn V. So, we'll need some pretty huge rockets. Let's get to work. I present to you the Goliath 1B. Weighing in at over 20 kilotons,
hip, hip.
it's got the power to lift a measly 16 tons into low Kerbin orbit.
Hip, hip.
Yeah, that sounds low, but for this Kerbin at least, it's a hell of a lot. If I made the rocket much bigger than this, the game would just turn into a Microsoft PowerPoint presentation, and just one launch would take literally an hour, so yeah, it was kind of our only option here. Oh yeah, another effect of this Kerbin being ridiculously huge is that even getting to orbit takes forever, usually at least 15 minutes.
The last proton should be decaying about now.
Anyways, back to the rocket. Its first stage is powered by 68 Mammoth engines and 16 Vectors, producing a total of 240 meganewtons of thrust on launch, and probably making enough noise to shatter windows at the Iowan airfield. Alright, so now that you've seen that affront to God of a launch vehicle, it's time to take a look at the actual spacecraft it will be carrying into orbit, with the most uninspired name imaginable.
Wow! How original!
The Supermoon. Yeah. It's comprised of 5 different parts, each of which will be. Each of which will be. I did it again, are you serious? Each of which will be launched separately due to the insane delta V requirements. The lander, the command module, and the 3 fuel modules, all of which will be docked together in low Kerbin orbit. All told, it should have around 8 kilometers per second of delta V, which it better have considering we need it to spend 5 of those just to get an encounter with the moon. Originally, I also wanted to have it use only chemical engines instead of nuclear engines, but this was scrapped after I realized how many tanks I would need and some rather unfortunate incidents. Yeah, speaking of unfortunate incidents and failures, there were lots of them, and many were incredibly frustrating. First, there were the numerous failures to even get the rocket to work in the first place, as the first stage has a tendency to go 4th of July mode when it's driving.
Why can you see by the dawn's early light?
Which resulted in the second stage being caught in the blast radius and destroyed, causing a total failure. Luckily, I was able to work around this by spreading the boosters out more and moving them a little further downwards. Another thing that happened multiple times was me failing to reach orbit by incredibly thin margins, which was probably the most frustrating of all. Alright, just a little more, come on. Are you fucking kidding me right now? You've actually gotta be shitting me. There was also a time that I forgot to disable fuel crossfeed on the docking port, which resulted in me successfully launching a fuel tank into orbit, only to discover that half of its fuel was missing. Finally, there was the issue of the game just deciding to go crazy for no reason, and several times after I changed out the payload, the rocket would either just blow up on the launch pad or wobble around uncontrollably before falling apart mid-launch. I honestly have no idea why this happened, but luckily just reloading the save enough time seemed to fix it. Alright, enough dilly-dallying. Let's actually get to the mission.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. All engine running. Liftoff. We have a liftoff. 32 minutes past the hour.
Launches here were the fuel tanks, and once I had worked out most of the problems, getting them to orbit wasn't too hard. Other than having to carefully pitch so I wouldn't just pass my apoapsis and start falling back to Kerbin. We're aiming for a velocity of 13.1 kilometers per second, which is orbital velocity in Kerbinzilla's low orbit. So now that this has been completed, we can finally launch the actual command module, and, of course, Jebediah Kerman, because who else was it gonna be? After waiting 15 minutes to get into orbit, I then docked the command module to the fuel module, except I couldn't. As it turns out, the hitboxes of the nuclear engines were actually bigger than their models, which meant that they just hit the sides of the fuel tank without actually looking like it. I then tried several times to get the angle exactly right, and... Well, shit. I don't want to have to do this launch all over again. Luckily, though, I wouldn't have to, as by using Time Warp at exactly the right moment, I got the docking ports to stick. Following this conundrum, I then sent up the lander, and... Before I knew it... The ship was built. We were finally ready to go to the moon. I then fired up the engines and... This is taking a while. This is awesome. Approximately 10 ejection burn passes later, we had our trajectory set up, and off we went. Arriving at the moon went like a typical moon mission would, with a short orbital insertion burn at a periapsis of roughly 20 kilometers above the surface. However, during this burn, the frame rate suddenly took a nosedive for some reason, and I got to experience what playing KSP2 feels like, except with 90% less bugs in an actual feature-complete game.
Our ultimate goal is to slay the Kraken.
In this simulated sequel experience, I then flew Jeb over to the lander and undocked it for the descent. Landing on this moon was actually pretty difficult, as you need more Delta V to do it than landing on Tylo in the stock game. You also have to take into account your trajectory decaying pretty quickly once you start decelerating, meaning that you have to radial out a bit to avoid crashing.
Touchdown confirmed. We're safe on Mars.
After a pretty janky descent and the frame rate suddenly popping back once we were within a few meters of the surface, we finally touched down on the surface of the moon, and Jeb planted the flag some meters away. Following this, we conducted some science experiments and took in the view of Kerbinzilla from more than 300,000 kilometers away. After frolicking about for a bit and getting bored,
yeah, I did it! I'm the first Kerbal on the moon! Wait a second. This place is boring as hell.
Waiting for the command module to be in the right place in orbit, it was time for Jeb to leave the moon. Following some last-minute fuel transfers, we lifted off, leaving the descent stage behind on the surface, Apollo-style. Just after takeoff, however, the Fermate once again decided it didn't want to live anymore. And consequently, getting into orbit took absolutely forever and was quite boring. Wow, would you look at that, we've made the rendezvous. Following this, we then made the escape burn and made our way all the way back home. Now it was time for re-entry. Now, I know what you're thinking. You're going over 18 kilometers per second. There's absolutely no way you'll survive re-entry. When I first tested out this mod, I actually thought this too, but it turns out that, for whatever reason, Sigma Dimension scales re-entry heat down with the size of the planets, or something like that. I really have no idea why it's less severe now. Regardless, it made it actually possible to survive re-entry, if you don't mind pulling over 15 Gs because my trajectory was a little steep. Once the heat of re-entry had subsided, and we were within a few kilometers of the surface, Jeb ejected from his capsule and safely parachuted down to the surface. Which from here very much resembles a Minecraft superflat world. I don't know, just watch out for the slimes, Jeb. Anyways, that was me going to the moon in 30 times scale, which was probably one of the most interesting and difficult missions I've ever done in KSP. I don't even want to imagine trying to go interplanetary with this enabled. That just seems like it'd be an absolute nightmare, but yeah, thanks for watching.